It's the right angle to catch your eye.
All right, I appreciate that.
All right, welcome back, everybody. We're going to start with our next panel here. A distinguished group of my colleagues from the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. One program note, Brad Schrade, who was scheduled to be on this panel, is over at the state legislature covering what I believe is very, very good news for senior care in Georgia, and I think that our panelists might speak to that news shortly. But on my immediate right, Andre Jackson, our editorial editor, will be moderating today. Lois Norder, investigations editor, my colleague, and the editor of the Unprotected series, which you're going to learn more about today. And on her right, my longtime friend and colleague, Carrie Teegardin, who was, along with Brad Schrade, the reporter on this very, very important series. My role here going forward is going to be to control the audiovisual and PowerPoint, so you won't hear anything more from me except expressions of exasperation over the laptop and whether it responds to my commands. We're going to start with a short video that will quickly bring you up to speed about the Unprotected series, which published in the AJC last year and has been the subject of continuing coverage as the legislature decides how to address the very, very serious issues that the series exposed.
You start with one question, and then before you know it, you are involved in an investigation.
The Atlanta Journal-Constitution exposes how Georgia fails to protect senior citizens.
We're taking a look at the assisted living and personal care home industry.
A very close look at every facility in Georgia. It was shocking.
Families had no way of knowing what's really going on.
Okay, my colleague Ken Foskett has the most important job of making sure the PowerPoint works. Journalists usually aren't that familiar with those things, but we will sort of get through it. So, hope you all enjoy the music while we're going here. Given that we are journalists here, I think we can start by actually breaking some news here, which is what we do for a living. So with that, I will turn to my distinguished colleagues here and let them announce the news. And you can tell from the grins that it is significant.
We stood outside this chamber and watched the House chamber over at not far from here at the Capitol pass House Bill 987, which we were credited with being the force behind that happening. Sharon Cooper authored this bill, and it passed 160-1. And they read part of our story on the House floor, and I'm so gratified right now.
Is a stunning accomplishment, and the fact that it came this morning as we were standing in the hall watching the previous session, that's incredible for us. We have a PowerPoint that we will walk through here as well, but I wanted to briefly describe the project Unprotected as an effort involving the best journalists at the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, including a gentleman who is due to be here today, but is actually down at the Gold Dome reporting on the events there today around this bill. So we put our best people on it, and we tried to do our part for an effort that represents why many of us went into this business, which was to do our modest part to help make this world a better place. And I believe through our reporting and on the opinion pages, which are separate from our news operation, our advocacy, hopefully we are making a difference for Georgians and for particularly vulnerable Georgians. And I think many people in this room have probably had experience with elder care and senior care, and I believe we can all see the need for changes and improvements in the way that we provide that in Georgia. So with that said, we can go into the PowerPoint. We will be happy to entertain questions. We're in a room full of journalists and lawyers. Both groups ask lots of questions, so we're happy to entertain those. For my lawyer friends here, the folks who are used to making opening and closing arguments at some length, I would ask that you keep your questions somewhat brief so that we can answer and get in as many questions as possible. With that said, my colleague.
Couldn't match the PowerPoint slides to the questions if we okay. want to dive in there, and we'll proceed along with some explanation.
Speak into the mic.
Yes.
That will work, sir. Mr. Foskett, I believe that is your cue to begin the PowerPoint, if you could.
Okay. So we just did the, we're on this slide here. I think.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Homes are being built everywhere. It is a growth industry in Georgia. As the population gets older, people are living longer beyond what many of us thought was possible. And that is creating some challenges that we found in our work, which is a good point in place at which to ask Carrie in particular, and Lois, feel free to jump in as well. You know, what got the AJC started on this? I believe you're the person who figuratively gave birth to this effort some years ago. So if you could please tell us about that.
Well, I had gotten kind of obsessed with this gentleman named Christopher Brogdon, who happens to live at the top of the St. Regis in one of the most expensive condos in Atlanta. He has a really nice house on St. Simon's and an airplane, and he amassed his fortune by being one of the worst senior care operators in America. He was really famous for enticing elderly people in Florida to invest in his projects through municipal bonds, and then, you know, having them default and just going on to the next project. Nobody ever stopped him, and he's still living at the top of the St. Regis, so stop by and say hi. We did a story about him, but through that process, we kind of got interested in this assisted living industry. I don't know if any of you guys noticed, you drive around Atlanta, every corner it seems like, you know, some kind of fabulous, really club-like looking assisted living is going up. And we kind of got the idea through the reporting on Brogdon that these things may not be the fabulous things that we thought. I happened to actually be at the Capitol about a decade ago when this type of facility was first authorized. It had taken advocates almost 10 years to get this bill passed because it was fought by the nursing home industry, and it was seen as a solution, a non-institutional, residential, very comfortable place for people who didn't need 24-hour care. And it was passed with very high hopes. And with that history, I think we knew that this was an industry that needed to be examined closely once we got a sense that things weren't what they seemed. And that's what kind of sent us on our journey.
I believe you can take to the next one. Any thoughts on your end to add to that, Lois?
No, when we did get started, this was back in 2017 where we really started saying what's out there, what would allow us to analyze what's going on in these homes, and there was so little information available, but what little that we did see in starting to find some inspection reports online was very surprising and alarming to us because it spoke to problems that I think the people paying to put their loved ones in these homes would never have anticipated and may not have been visible to them going in to visit. So that surprised us. And Mike Lukovich, our cartoonist, later did a cartoon that kind of speaks to the difference between the image and the reality that we were seeing at the homes. Carrie, early on, heard from one of the advocates that it's so important to look past the chandeliers in these homes. And that became kind of a theme looking through these, many of these homes. They're beautiful looking on first impression when you go in. That doesn't speak to the quality of care that's going on in the homes.
And I believe many folks in this room, certainly in Atlanta and in Georgia, have lived through that experience. I know personally I did as well. As the opinion editor, I wasn't involved in the day-to-day reporting. We sort of maintain a pretty high wall between news and opinion operations at the AJC. But I was watching what they were doing as an end user, so to speak, and cheering them on. And I was also recalling my own personal experience in my own household. At one point, we had two 90-year-olds under our roof with dementia. And we eventually had to look for places for my mom as well as my mother-in-law. And we had an experience that's Mike captured it in his cartoon. As we looked around at these places, yeah, a lot of them had nice chandeliers. They had card games going on. They had activities. They looked great. All of us here, journalists, are trained as professional skeptics. I like to think of us as skeptics rather than cynics, and that we ask tough questions and think about things in ways similar to lawyers, I believe, in terms of trying to figure out what's really going on. And in looking around a couple of these places, I remember being struck by, it looks good, but what's the real experience like? Well, we found out when we moved my mother-in-law in one. The first night she fell, dislocated her shoulder. I wrote a piece about that about a month ago. She was on very few medications for a lady who's now 98 years old, but the med staff at one of these places, it was one of the big fancy homes, part of a chain. They could not get her three or four medications to her consistently at the right times and in the right manner. So we eventually pulled her out of there, but I mean, it really led me to wonder personally, and I was thrilled beyond measure to see that our reporters were working on that story and pushing forward on that, and the end result is sort of what came to be the still ongoing unprotected project. Now that's it. Getting to where we got involved a lot of digging and research and effort and expenditure of time and effort on the part of journalists here. And if we could talk about that a little bit, we're big advocates in the news business for open, transparent government and operations. And when our taxpayer dollars are at work, how are they being spent? How well are they being spent? So that's our stock in trade. So if you all could talk a little bit about what we're seeing in this photo here.
I really pride myself in trying to build relationships and open communication with the people that we're covering, even under tent situations. That applied even to a series we did on sexually abusive doctors. That was a very tough test of can you communicate even with people who are in a tough situation when you call. Generally, we think that our state agency should answer our questions and kind of explain how they go about their work. The Department of Community Health is not an agency that believes in that. We struggled mightily to engage with them, even just on background conversations to understand what your process, call and explain, just to find out your process. We want to get all your data. We're going to be using it. And they were very hostile to our investigation, to the point of even not even wanting to say hi, down at the Capitol. And I do know that, people from their own industry, the industry they regulate call, they don't have trouble getting them to say hi or answer their questions. And so that became very frustrating. But their records were the heart of this project. Lois and I spent many, many days just reading inspection reports. That's when we first started to get an idea of the kinds of things that were going on. And what the response was from the state. We also were very helped in this project through police reports, which is not something we expected. We wanted to start looking at some police reports. Lois had this idea to say, hey, if we saw what looked like a crime in an inspection report, did that get reported to police? And when we started getting police reports, what we found out is there was all sorts of stuff in police reports that we'd never seen in these state regulatory records. And we started getting more and more police reports and finding out more and more information.
And we also saw things in the inspection reports that weren't in police records. So someone is beaten up by a caregiver in a home, one would expect, given the Georgia law on elder abuse, that this would have been reported to police and possibly criminal charges would have been filed. Probably in half the cases, that never occurred. The police were not told about abuse against the elderly in these homes.
And just getting a complete record from the agency, we're still struggling with that. We're more than a year in. We just had to write them a letter over the fact that they won't give us electronic copies of their database. We basically had to work from paper records on this whole entire project and build our own ratings website from PDFs, which are the equivalent of paper records. And their argument is that, well, they use a software created by the federal government, so we need to go to the federal government to get their records, which is kind of like saying, because I use Microsoft Word, I need to go to Bill Gates to get some kind of a document that was created. So that the amount of frustration we've had in trying to deal with this state agency has been remarkable to me in 30 years of being a reporter at this newspaper.
Yeah, and if you look at some of the other PowerPoint slides, you go through some of the other we have a number of other barriers that we reached throughout, and I thought we could talk about some of those. One of the problems early on for what many reports were not online. The ones that you do find online, Ken, if you can go to the next slide, I want to show you an example. I know you can't read this, but this is one violation at one home. Very lengthy, full of medical jargon, the names of prescription drugs, medical terms for health conditions and things. And so for the average member of the public, if you happened to find this website and you happened to pull up the violations, which meant you understood the difference between an assisted living community and a personal care home, and you knew where to look and you clicked on the right buttons, you'd get this that was probably incomprehensible. But on the next slide, here's what it translates into. This facility didn't give a resident there, an elderly person, their medication for 2 weeks, and they had to be hospitalized and suffered a seizure because they didn't get their medication. You probably wouldn't know that unless you had some kind of medical background or you Googled every word in the DCH report to understand what was going on. So that was one of the problems we saw going in, and also a problem for us as we tried to say, how can we understand this data as we put it into our database and see what are the patterns of problems that are in here. Here's a medication error. How often did medication errors occur in these homes? DCH does not track that information. It does not track how often people are abused. It does not track how often people with dementia wander away from homes. Any category we ask about, DCH does not keep data on those issues. And so we decided we would do that ourselves and went through, how many reports, Carrie?
Tons. Thousands.
Of reports and built our own databases so that we could get a grasp on what was going on in these homes.
I was struck, going back a little bit, when Carrie was talking, at the point where they were told to go to the federal government to get information because of the software. And I was sitting here thinking just now, I said, boy, how often in the state of Georgia do you hear a state agency say the federal government has all the answers? So I haven't heard that in my nearly 12 years in Atlanta. I would also say to DCH, in what I do, again, on the opinion side of the aisle, I try to reach out and create a marketplace of ideas. And I reached out to DCH early on in this project when I knew that this series was coming and I knew we would be editorializing it and opining on it. I said, well, you know, I am interested in getting an op-ed from you in your own words, your own voice, what your response and answers to. This is your chance to tell your side of the story without a reporter in it to choose which parts to use or say or whatever. I mean, obviously we edit things that come in for style and clarity on the opinion page even, but I said, well, you know, here's your chance to tell your story on a page and, you know, get your side of the issue. They thought about it for a while and said, we choose not to do that. Thank you for the opportunity. And that's fine, that's their right, but it struck me as telling in that this is a state agency using our money, a public agency that uses the taxpayers' money, and you know, it seemed like, boy, if I were on their communications side at that agency, I would have taken the opportunity to provide their side of the story and some answers, but they chose not to do that. So I just thought, yeah, you know, that, it was telling. I mean, I don't know what it points to or what their thinking is over there, but I thought that was telling. So that's it. We can go to the next page. We've talked about this a little bit, but there are some other missing pieces that you all ran across. In particular, I think of their website that was very missing for a while. So I don't know
if you advance one more?
One more, please.
I guess we should let you know that as part of this project, we created our own ratings website, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. But one of the reasons we did this was because of all the missing information and the difficulty in accessing it. But there were homes where, you know, they just weren't posting inspections, or, you know, we couldn't tell whether they had done an inspection or whether they were holding back. And we'd heard from people in the industry that was often 6 months to a year after they actually came out and inspected before they'd finished their report, which didn't seem like that did anybody any good. You know, if you hadn't waited a year to see that your restaurant had failed an inspection, you would already be sick with salmonella or whatever it was. We also found that they would remove, you know, if somebody bought the facility or they just did a slight change in name, they would remove all the reports. The reports would just disappear, even ones that had been online, and there was no real rhyme or reason to what was on there and what wasn't, and we could never get a good explanation for that.
Here's one that disappeared early on when we were going through manually through the website. We compiled We printed out copies of every abuse report, and so later on when we were going through trying to figure out what was going on at these homes, suddenly we see reports that we have in our abuse binder that there's no reports from anymore on the website. We didn't get them from DCH in our records request. Luckily, because we had printed out every abuse report, we were able to resurrect these, and never did get an explanation, did we, from Carrie, up from DCH, on why these reports suddenly were removed from the website. It's not because the name changed, although that was a reason other reports disappeared. There were some homes, by the way, where it might have changed from Grand House at Colonial to Grand House of Colonial, and then it would wipe out all the previous reports. And so if you wanted to see what had happened the year before, it wasn't there. There were also cases where, while the place changed names completely, we were able to determine it was still owned and operated by the same people, but because of the name change, all the prior inspection reports were removed from the website, and you would not have known about problems at the homes.
Now think about this for a second. Look at that report and picture yourself an end user trying to find information, do your due diligence, a layperson, trying to find the best possible place to put your parent or a family member in these homes. And even when the website is functional, which it wasn't always, information comes, it goes, it's incomplete. There are gaps there, or even if you do find that piece of paper up there, how easily can you discern, can you mine it to get insights into where best to place your loved one? And consider also that the entire website was down for how long?
Months.
Months, yeah. It was down.
Yeah. after we started our reporting, the website went down totally. So even this information above wasn't there, that was on the screen there. So think of that, and again, just sort of an agency that should be doing its job on behalf of the public. That's what it's charged with doing. How good a job were they doing if that's what you found on that website? And that is a good part of the reason why the AJC took it upon itself to, as we gathered this information and as we compiled it, analyzed it, and sorted it, and did our rankings by various categories, that we decided to build a website for end users, for consumers, for our audience, to, based on our findings, to categorize that information in one easy-to-use place. Now, I like to think the state would have beaten us to that. Again, I'm the guy who's paid to express an opinion, so I can't ask these guys to do that. But thinking about it as a Georgia taxpayer, I sort of have wondered sometimes, you know, why did we have to do that? So, but it was what it was, and you know, we tried to work with it and tried to do our part to make an easy-to-use website to benefit Georgians who were faced with these kind of decisions, of care decisions. So, I think we can move on there.
This is another example of the differences between what an inspection report says and what it Ken, can you go to the next slide? In this case, the DCH report described a case of a person being abused by a caregiver. This caregiver at a home in Macon elbowed an elderly woman in the stomach and then struggled with her. The poor woman fell to the floor. Her front teeth were knocked out as a result of this. This happened in December 2018. The inspection report was not posted online until the past couple months, and so more than a year after this happened, the public would not have known. It wasn't until last August, which was 9 months after this occurred, that the home told police that this had happened. The police report, which we obtained, also said they wouldn't charge the caregiver in this case, who was fired by the home. So this was another one of the kinds of issues we came across, which said, you know, it was not uncommon to find that homes were not reporting all kinds of things that they are required to report, not just to police, but to DCH and others. And it was not uncommon to see that when abuse reports were made to police, that they did not pursue any criminal actions against the people who were the abusers. And it's we didn't get real clear explanations on that, other than at one point the some of the local district attorneys in DeKalb in particular and Cobb, some said police were not making them aware of the of these crimes that were reported to police. So the district attorneys, the prosecutors, were not getting the opportunity to review these.
One of the best elder abuse prosecutors in the state is in DeKalb County, and my colleague Brad Schrade went and met with her one day and presented her with a group of cases that we'd gotten out of reports, and she was just kind of mystified that she'd never heard about these cases and was pretty upset about it, and didn't say she would have necessarily brought charges, but at least wanted a chance to review the case. The same thing happened in Cobb, which also has an excellent prosecutor who actually prosecuted a murder case out of Sunrise at East Cobb. We brought a case to him that he had never heard about. And so that was a gap that we ended up doing a story we hadn't originally planned on doing about the fact that these folks weren't getting the information they knew. And these were in the counties that have the best elder abuse folks working on it. So you can imagine what would happen, you know, elsewhere. I think when we were thinking about this, Lois and I often kind of tried to think about the equivalent. You know, what if this was in a childcare center? How would that be viewed? Would it be okay to, you know, elbow and beat the kid and not have anybody think that was a problem? You know, we did the same thing when we did doctors and sex abuse. It was the scandal with the priest was very much in mind at that time. And I think elder abuse, which often involves dementia, police kind of tend to brush it off at this point in history. because they think, well, they either don't remember it or they remembered it wrong. We've seen that kind of explanation in other kinds of power imbalances. And it's amazing how often another story reveals when a family is shrewd enough to place a camera in their parents' room. So.
In this case, the Macon home where the woman got elbowed in the stomach, there actually was a video showing the abuse. The home originally told DCH that, oh, the woman just fell, and DCH came in, and this was a home that had a video in this common area where people did activities, and the video clearly showed this caregiver beating up this poor woman. And police knew that it was in the police report as well. They still decided not to file charges against us. One of the things that Brad found out is that police don't really understand their responsibilities on regarding elder abuse and neglect, what the laws are, and frankly, lots of people who are required by Georgia law to report elder abuse and neglect, which includes people at these senior care homes, they do not understand their responsibilities on this. And we could not find that there's ever been people charged for failing to report elder abuse and neglect out of these homes. It seems like it has never happened. And yet you'd see police reports where the police would note in there, unclear why they waited so long to report this. And it's like, well, that's a crime. There is actually another bill in the legislature right now that would increase the penalties when mandated reporters fail to report elder abuse and neglect, and that is kind of related to the senior care bill that's out there. Just to say, this is another problem that is very clear that's out there when it comes to the care of elderly people in Georgia, and it helps explain why some of these things are not happening that could better protect residents here.
As a guy who grew up in a family of three generations of police officers and other law enforcement folks, that sort of finding really was mind-boggling to me. I mean, I like to think about that our law enforcement would be doing a more consistent job in sort of investigating in a timely manner issues that they're aware of and moving to act on them where they can. So I think shining a light on this hopefully will, if not save lives, certainly help save people from abuse in the future going forward. So that's it. There are other agencies involved in Georgia in this, and we have had experience with them as well.
Lois had the great idea to check their restaurant inspections, because they all brag on their websites. Go to any website for one of these facilities, they always brag about their chef prepared meals. It's always like the little filet mignon with the three asparaguses over the top of that. And so that's like, obviously, if we're gonna have to eat someplace three meals a day, that is a big selling point. And but we found out some of these places had actually failed their restaurant inspections, which you would never know that if you were shopping, because all you would, hear about was how great their food was, and they would give you a special chef meal when you went on your tour. And this is something we actually included on our website. It was a fair amount of work for somebody on our team to get all these records, but we found it was worthwhile, because who would think that would be the case?
And here's the other part two of this is that the Department of Public Health does not communicate this to the Department of Community Health. So when they go in and find that a facility has failed the food inspection, DPH does not tell DCH. What's more, DPH is responsible for responding to disease outbreaks in senior care homes. So if you have influenza sweep through a place, or scabies, for example, anything that can be contagious, DPH is on point. DPH does not talk to DCH about this. And so DCH may not be aware if there are violations that might be a failure to train your staff on infection control principles. That's one of the requirements for these homes. But DCH might not be aware of this issue if they don't know that there are disease outbreaks in these homes. And
that Brad actually found out that in fact there had been a hearing at the legislature on the question of can we not get DPH to talk to DCH? And apparently, no, we can't. There's resistance. They don't want to communicate the information. And there's no legal requirement in Georgia for them to share the information, nor is there a requirement for, say, the fire marshal to report directly to DCH when it finds fire safety violations, which in some homes were extensive and could mean if we have fires, which we have had in senior care facilities, we're going to have people die as a result, and yet the fire marshal's reports do not go to DCH. Instead, the home is expected to report them and have records on them. So when DCH comes in every couple of years to do the inspection and finds out, oh yeah, your sprinkler system's broken and your fire extinguishers are all expired and you haven't done your fire drills, it's like, oops, yeah, didn't know that.
One of the interesting things about this project is the responses we've gotten from readers. And looking at that public health report about the food service, readers have told us that menus, if you need a special menu as you get older, if you're diabetic, if you're hypertensive, if you need this low sodium menu, low sugar menu, that sort of thing, a lot of these places that are charging, shall I say, hefty amounts for these places, for rent every month, they charge you extra if you need a certain diet, if you need certain food, if you need less food or more food. In addition, it's all sort of this a la carte menu, which was interesting to learn as readers told us about that. And as to matters of public health as well, our reporting uncovered instances of vermin in these places, ants and rodents, and people suffering as a result of that, you being bedridden and attacked by ants, and this causing injuries that were either that worsened your condition greatly, if not helped contribute to your demise prematurely, perhaps. So it's just sort of that lack of communication between agencies charged with protecting the public was eye-opening to us.
And just to give you some context on the price, it's about ranges from about $4,000 up to $12,000 a month to be in one of these facilities. It's private pay, anything in Georgia that's 25 beds or over. And yet the staff that's doing the actual hands-on care is usually $10 to $12 an hour employees and people who are very stretched thin with no training. These are not medical facilities. Generally, there doesn't under current law, this is perhaps will change if this bill makes it through. You don't have to have anybody with any real medical training on staff. There's it's not like a nursing home. And so we saw many problems just related to that. Imagine yourself, you're a $10 an hour worker, maybe didn't even finish high school, and you're in charge of 25 people with dementia at night, one person. That's what Georgia current law allows. Imagine I think some of the most heartbreaking narratives within these reports were the descriptions of what these workers were up against. You know, they had to get up all these people who couldn't necessarily get themselves out of bed, had to get them dressed. They were also having to wrap silverware and put the trays out and try to feed people. I mean, just put yourself in that situation as an employee and then put yourself in a position of being someone who has trouble verbalizing what their needs are. And you can see how heartbreaking many of these situations are, not just for your family member that you've paid $10,000 a month there in this beautiful setting and you've been told everyone is well trained, and yet behind the scenes, this kind of stuff that went on was truly just so troubling. Again, not just for the person who's often very helpless, but for these workers. And there's no surprise that they have at least a 50% turnover rate in these facilities. So even if you did get someone who you had a good relationship with and got to know your mother and what your mother was trying to express, there's a very good chance that, you know, 2 months later, that person is going to be gone.
And training violations were very common at these homes. There are homes where inspection after inspection, they find that you didn't train the staff on first aid. Well, imagine you're at a home with 200 elderly people and the staff doesn't know how to give first aid. They haven't been trained in CPR. I mean, these are basic skills that you would think the caregiver had at the home, and the homes get cited again and again for failure to do that.
Go ahead.
Do you want to advance this one? I just wanted to make one other point, and that's the failure of operators to provide information they're required to do, which was a barrier all along.
One thing that's in the current bill is, you know, if you want to be a nail tech in Georgia, you have to go through a training and licensing project. If you want to cut hair, if you want to be an attorney, you know, if you want to even be a nursing home administrator, right, you've got to go through this process to show you have some competence for that, since there's a, you know, potential health issue involved. Almost anybody can be run an assisted living facility, okay? It's almost no requirements. And we kept seeing in these reports, and it really got to me and Lois after you read, you know, hundreds of these things, you kind of get roll your eyes after the 100th time. Oh, I didn't know I had to report that. Oh, I didn't know they had to be trained. Oh, I didn't know that, you know, we couldn't do this or that. And so one of the things that is in this current bill is that you would have to get a license and go through some kind of training process to be an administrator of an assisted living. And we were kind of gratified to see that.
Okay, it looks like I was given the 10-minute sign 2 minutes ago, so.
Can we talk about the data? Just really quickly, we only found two other states that rate assisted living facilities because it is a difficult and complex thing, but we decided that the only way to really help people understand what's in these reports, given we couldn't go through and translate into English all the inspection reports. So once we classified reports, Carrie came up with a system of rating the severity of violations at homes, and this involved a statute-by-statute review of all the regulations and then a knowledge of what went on at all of these homes. And then we developed an algorithm for deciding which homes had so many problems that we should red flag them. And so we ended up actually with 20% of the homes in Georgia where we found such extensive problems that our website gives a little red flag on them, so you would know, you know, take a close look at this one if you're considering it. And Ken, if you'll go to the next page. And when you click on a home, you get through a series of symbols to also help readers understand what's in these reports. Things that would say, and there's a letter H, which means because of a violation, someone was harmed. There's a symbol that says they've been cited for a problem again and again. There's a symbol that says the violations at this home were pretty severe. So this was our attempt to say, given the complexity of this, we want to help people be able to understand.
Okay. Let's see. If you could briefly touch on the final points in here, in particular, the new bill and how it addresses weak state laws in Georgia. Then I think we can go to questions. Maybe.
Yeah, the new bill, as I mentioned, deals with training, not just with executive directors, but with frontline staff, the number of staff that you would have, creating a special certification for memory care centers, which now anyone can just open that and say they're doing it.
And DCH, by the way, said it couldn't tell us how many people had memory care centers.
Was changing the staffing requirement in these centers to current number is 1 to 12, 24 hours instead of going down to 1 to 25. That's still going to be a stretch in some cases. And also increasing fines. Currently, if you have a violation that leads to one of your residents' deaths, the typical violation, even if they do cite you, which is not always the case, is $601. That's a really small amount when you kill someone that was in your care. They're talking about doubling that now. So
one other requirement in the bill would require administrators of these homes to pass a competency exam. We found that 35 other states had higher requirements for administrators than Georgia has.
and having a competency exam to say that you have to know the rules and regulations of these homes if you're going to run them, and then getting state licenses is a key part of this bill that I think will mean that we should not see all of these, I did not know this was a requirement, in excuses in the DCH reports.
Okay, as promised, and I think by my timing calculations, we've got about 5 or 6 minutes left. Are there any questions? We certainly wanted to leave time for that. Wow, I was worried there wouldn't be any. So.
See if I can get this on. Here we go.
Mine will hopefully be very quick. How much did AJC invest in the website? Because that's a tremendous public service. So thank you for that, by the way.
We mostly invested, sure. Me and Lois, working a lot of nights and weekends reading reports.
Yeah, we can tell you a lot about the time invested in it. Being a newspaper and us not being math majors, I can't give you a dollar amount for what we did, but we believed it was worth the investment and the application of the skill set.
Yeah, I'd also note that we are fortunate to have a team of data specialists, one in particular, Emily, who designed the website and made it workable with her programming skills, and so Carrie and I did not program the site. We just came up with the content and the algorithm for.
It's all in house. We did it all ourselves.
Yeah, and by the way, we're about to update the website and provide additional information for people.
Okay, simple question. What's the name of the website? Is it AJC Unprotected or something?
Yes, AJC.com/unprotected will get you there. Simple.
Please tell all your friends.
Thank you guys again for the website. In regards to the infractions or the violations, does the information that you all gathered touch on any abuse at the hands of one resident to another?
Yes. Yes, resident-on-resident abuse is common. We found that often, and people, if you talk to them about that, that's related to, you know, people with dementia, you know, that's very common. It's a signal that there's understaffing or lack of training, that someone doesn't know how to recognize that situation and very kindly de-escalate. And there, in some homes, that was rampant and repeated, that one resident would be victimized by another, even sexually abused by another resident. And some of those cases were troubling. One Lois talked to about repeatedly was where a hospice nurse, who wasn't part of that facility, actually assigned extra hospice staff to one of their people in their hospice program because the facility wasn't protecting her from a predatory other resident. And that was disturbing to see that the facilities weren't staffing and training appropriately. Every violation, the vast majority, dealt with understaffing or undertraining.
And in that particular case, the victim, the woman, had been repeatedly sexually abused by another resident there, and the home did nothing.
Okay, I'm hearing we have time for one more question.
Well, fantastic work, you all. My question is, were you able to use experts? And I know you said Brad talked to prosecutors, but medical experts, did you have anyone like that?
Oh, yes, of course. I talked to a woman who was one of the foremost experts in assisted living who had testified in Congress. I watched like the C-SPAN video going back 20 years, who kept warning that people in assisted living were a lot more frail than what that system had ever imagined. They kind of viewed it as like baby boomers who were in good shape, who just wanted 3 meals a day and in case they needed a reminder to take their pills. I mean, that's kind of what it was about. She'd been trying to sound the alarm on this for probably 20 years, and nothing has ever happened. But many experts, I mean, we talked to a lot of people within the industry. When I wanted a question answered that I couldn't get the department to answer, I would call people within the industry and try to get them. Sometimes they'd even call the department for me, and they'd get it. I'd also like to note that with our website and stuff, we contacted every single senior home that we listed. We told them what we would be providing and information about them, and we gave them the opportunity to address anything they thought was incorrect or that make any comment that they wanted to say, because we were trying to be very transparent and to let the industry know we want to communicate with you. We want to hear what you have to say on this.
Okay, I believe I am getting the hook. So thank you, Ken. Thank you, panel. Thank you, audience.
We're going to take just a few minutes to grab your lunches and bring them back in. We're going to start the next panel sharp at 12:30. So you have a comfort break and grab your lunch and bring it back in. Ready to go at 12:30.
Hey, Mary. Hey, Mary. Teegardin.
Hey. Good job.
We rode around in your car together years ago for housing code. I don't know if you remember that. That was years ago.